Well, thanks, Klaus, and good afternoon, everyone. The world is talking about the amazing event of the 8th of November. Nobody expected it. The Time magazine, in their issue just before the election, and by the way, they didn't make the foolish mistake of Newsweek and call the election for Hillary Clinton, they nevertheless highlighted the dilemma of the American people. Most Americans, of course, thought that Donald Trump and indeed Clinton were unsuitable candidates. And it didn't seem to matter what political party you belonged to. The Republicans, most of them, thought that Donald Trump should not have been their candidate. Is this the best that we can do from a nation of 335 million people? These two? They were amazed. But of course, those who know their Bible know that God was actually at work in these events, as we will see. Neither candidate passed the normal character test, the moral character test, did they? And world opinion is aghast at Trump's election. You can't turn on the radio. You can't look up any news, can you, without reference being made to the effect that this has on the politics of the world. Trump's name is everywhere, and nobody seems to know, perhaps he doesn't know, what his policies will be when he takes office on the 20th of January 2017. So why? Why has this happened? Why is it happening in the same year that the British voted to leave the European Union? There are reasons, we believe, for that. Few foresaw this coming, as they didn't foresee the exit of Britain from the European Union. Now, of course, during the campaign, Donald Trump made a fool of himself on numerous occasions, making outrageous statements that offended many in his own party and even his own entourage that were organising his campaign. And so, it's an amazing thing, isn't it? He was accused of disrespect and immoral treatment of women, of racism, of tax evasion, of all sorts of things during the campaign. It just didn't seem to matter. Most Americans were sick to death of the current political system. They would have voted for a monkey if the monkey had promised to change things. Clinton promised more of the same. They just wanted someone to do something at last. And so Donald Trump won that election. You know, there is a biblical passage that we believe bears very heavily on this matter. It is Daniel chapter 4 and verse 17. Now you see that flashing at the bottom of the screen there? Let me make this point at the outset before I say anything about Daniel 4:17. This verse is why Christadelphians do not get involved in the politics of this world. We do not vote at elections because we don't know beforehand who God wants to be in office. He can put there the most extraordinary characters, of which Donald Trump is one, and so was Adolf Hitler, to fulfill Jeremiah chapter 16. So God can put into power anyone that he wants to use for his purpose. But this verse is also telling you the reason why there is no one on earth more interested in politics than Christadelphians. We're interested because we can see in that the unfolding purpose of God. This verse says this, Daniel 4:17. This matter is by the decree of the watchers. These are the words of Daniel to the great king Nebuchadnezzar. And the demand by the word of the holy ones. So the holy ones and the watchers here are the angels that God sends forth to manipulate the affairs of nations to bring to pass his purpose. And he has an intent in doing that. He wants people to see his hand at work in the nations. Because it goes on to say, to the intent that the living may know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he will. Yes, there's an intent that we can see the hand of God at work. And then look at the rest of the Bible and see that it's worked right through history and that it is going to work for the future. God has a purpose with this earth. And in fulfilling that purpose, he sometimes will put men in power that nobody really thinks should be in power. He sets up over it the basest of men. Now that can be interpreted at a higher level. But it's also true in history that God puts in power the basis for the lowest of men. Donald Trump certainly fits that characterisation. Time magazine in June this year had this article about this election. America's anger is out of control, was the heading. By now, the article said, it's hardly news that we are in the middle of what has been relentlessly dubbed the anger election. Bernie Sanders supporters are mad, and many of them actually didn't end up voting for Clinton of their own party. Donald Trump's supporters are really mad. That was proved in the election, wasn't it? The electorate as a whole is mad, to the tune of nearly 80% of us saying we are dissatisfied or angry with the way the government is operating, and that's why he won. So they actually latched on to what was happening in America. But this is very interesting to us, because that anger is not just seen in America. It was seen in Britain on June the 23rd. It's being seen in Europe on the decisions of the European leaders to let all of these immigrants coming in. You know, all of the people that have got nowhere to live. It's seen all through the earth. And that is a sign. Because Revelation 11 verse 18 says this, and the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come. So what time is this? Well, it's the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. We know from what is happening around us, as we see the world descending into this kind of anger, that we're living in the days of the appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ from the right hand of God in heaven. And this year has been a dramatic year, an extraordinary year of signs given to us by our God that he is about to send his son. We need to be ready for that, because the next thing that is going to happen on the back of that event will be, as our chairman said, the re-establishment of the kingdom of God on the earth. So Revelation 11 verse 15 says this in that same section of scripture. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Yes, God looks down upon humanity. He doesn't see a multitude of nations. He sees them as one kingdom, the kingdom of men. And it will shortly be subsumed into the kingdom of God and of Christ, who will reign on this earth for 1,000 years. That's where all these things are heading, ladies and gentlemen. So why was Donald Trump elected against all the odds? Well, I want to just spend a few minutes on that. It's very important. Trump's daughter, Ivanka, by his first wife, Ivana — he's had, by the way, three wives, some say four, although you never quite know with that man. So his first wife had this daughter who's become very famous in due course. Ivanka is married to an Orthodox Jew, and she's committed to Jewish Orthodoxy. So you see, there it's in his own family, his relationship to Jewishness and to Israel. During the election campaign, he boasted many times that he would be a much stronger supporter of Israel than either President Obama had been, and that wouldn't be hard, and certainly than Hillary Clinton. And I want to talk about Hillary Clinton's attitude to Israel in a moment. Trump's promises in the campaign about Israel were many. Here's just a few of them. He made it very clear where he stood. He spoke of his unbreakable friendship with the state of Israel, whom he says is our closest ally. He said that he would give a much stronger support in the United Nations for Israel than the US has in the past. In other words, he would use the US veto power in the Security Council a lot more often. His number one priority, he said, was to dismantle Obama's disastrous nuclear deal with Iran. Of course, that worries Israel immensely. And it's the reason why Israel is now seeking some security in a relationship with Russia. He said he will not allow Israel to be treated like a second-class citizen by Arab states or anyone else. And he said that the US embassy in Israel will be moved to Jerusalem. Now, the Palestinians are going to be really happy about that. So you see, this man has got some very clear policies about Israel. Whether or not he follows through, only time will tell. But there is an overarching principle in all of this that gives the reason as to why this man succeeded against all the odds. We want to deal with that now. It's the principle spelled out to the father of the nation of Israel, Abraham. You can read the record of his life from Genesis 12 onwards. And the very first promise that God made to Abraham is clear. He says to him, I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. History. History is full of evidence of the truth of that statement. Spectacularly marked with the records of nations who have supported Israel prospering because they supported Israel, and other nations who have opposed Israel were cursed. Now that, of course, also has a higher meaning. But at the plain bottom level, that is telling us why things have happened the way they have in recent times. So let's just go back and have a look at recent history in relation to America and Israel. President Harry Truman was instrumental in gaining statehood for Israel between 1947 and 1948, and their subsequent admission to the United Nations in 1949. By the way, the Australian government was strongly involved in that, and they experienced the blessing as a result of that, as indeed did Harry Truman. The US helped Israel win three wars, the Sinai Campaign of 1956, the Six-Day War of 1967, the Yom Kippur War of 1973. And Israel, of course, since those times, has relied on US finance very, very strongly. But now, of course, Israel does not need the US to prop it up anymore. They've got a prime minister who knows how to run an economy. And the US can no longer afford it anyway with their $20 trillion debt to the rest of the world. Under President Obama, US relations with Israel have sunk to their lowest level in modern history. Now, why would that be the case, do you think? Well, you get a blessing if you bless Israel. You get a cursing if you curse them. On the 29th of November 1947, the partition motion to divide the land of Palestine, as it was then called, into two parts, into a Jewish state and an Arab state, was passed by 33 votes for, 13 against, 10 abstentions and 1 absentee. And that's important. We'll come back to that point a little later on. And this was accomplished largely by help from America and from Russia. And we'll come to that point in a minute. President Harry Truman came to power on the death of Franklin D. Roosevelt on the 12th of April 1945. Now, FDR, of course, was a sick man, but God took him out of the way because he wanted this man in power. When it came to the choice of supporting Israel. Now, Harry Truman was one of Israel's strongest and staunchest supporters and friends in that period of time. But he faced virulent opposition from his Secretary of State, the second most powerful person in the United States apart from the Vice President. The Secretary of State at the time was George Marshall. Heard of him? Ever heard of the Marshall Plan, which followed World War II to keep Berlin, the little enclave of Berlin, alive? And they flew planes in with supplies into Berlin. That was the Marshall Plan. Well, Marshall said to Truman, I am dead against the State of Israel being formed. And if you pursue this line, I will not vote for you in the coming election. At the end of 1948. Now, fancy your Secretary of State from your own party telling you that. Well, guess what? A newspaper came out the day after the election in 1948 saying, Thomas Dewey has won! Foolish as the Newsweek, because Thomas Dewey had not won. Against all the odds, Harry Truman was elected President of the United States. I wonder why. Well, I think you can see why. Those who bless Israel will be blessed. Those who curse Israel will be cursed. But there was another power involved. So there's Truman conferring with Abba Eban and David Ben-Gurion, the first premier or prime minister of Israel. But you see that man down there in the bottom right-hand corner? That's Andrei Gromyko, long-time foreign minister of Russia all through of the 1940s and 50s and 60s. He and the nation of Russia strongly supported the vote in the United Nations that the land should be divided, separated into two states. They strongly supported the formation of the nation of Israel. So what might have happened from that? Well, America and Russia were blessed. Post-World War II, America and Russia became world superpowers despite Russia suffering over 20 million casualties in the war and having their economy ruined. Yes, they came out of that. They became a world superpower. But when Russia supported Arab countries in subsequent wars against Israel, 1967 and 1973, the USSR, as it was called, was doomed. And that, of course, unwound, didn't it? Came to pass in 1989 through 1992, the USSR simply fell apart because they had turned against Israel. But they have a new leader today called Vladimir Putin. And guess what he's doing? He's cuddling up to Israel. He's saying that he's, in many ways, on their side. Well, of course, he speaks out of two sides of his mouth, that man. But he's actually trying to make Israel a friend, and I could give you a lot of information about that. But what about American policy in relation to Israel in recent times? Well, this gentleman here, who's is a journalist, as you can see, there's a long list of things in which he's involved on the screen there, and you can actually look this site up if you wish to do so. He wrote a long article about Hillary Clinton's attitude to Israel during the election campaign. I just want to quote you a couple of things out of that article. Let's just take the final paragraph first. Now, Hillary Clinton is running for president during the campaign. And she is campaigning on the basis that she is a friend of Israel, just as she did in the Senate, just as Obama did twice. As Secretary of State, she was the architect of the policy of the most anti-Israel president since the rebirth of Israel in 1948. It was a policy which reflected views she has held her entire life, with the exception of the 9-year period where she ran for and held the office of US Senator from New York State. You can't win an election in New York State unless you say you support the Jews, because it's full of Jews, millions of them. And they normally vote Democrat. Okay, so you can't win. But what was her former attitude to Israel? Except for these little periods where she needed Jewish support, as she did, of course, in the presidential election. Well, here are some quotes from the article. If one looks at Hillary Clinton's public history, one finds a lifetime of anti-Israel positions. Even before her marriage to Bill, Hillary Clinton was opposing Israel and promoting the forces of terrorism. Except for the time she needed New York's Jewish voting bloc, Hillary Clinton has never been pro-Israel. And when she held the position of Secretary of State, she helped Barack Obama craft his anti-Israel positions. So what kind of positions is he talking about? Well, what about this one? What about the ordering of a study which came out in July 2015, which is now sitting on every single desk in the State Department, informing US policy towards Israel and the Middle East? Well, this article says this. As you can see, it's from the Jerusalem Online News. In the wake of recent events, such as the US State Department defending boycotts against Israel's settlements and the US's appeasement to Iran, it appears that the Obama administration has been influenced by a study titled, now wait for it, this is the title of the study, Preparing for a Post-Israel Middle East. Now that means, in common layman's terms, a Middle East that doesn't have an Israel in it. A post-Israel Middle East. This is what's informing US policy right now. This is the result of Hillary Clinton being the Secretary of State of the United States of America. But the article goes on to say this. In that study, Israel was classified as the greatest threat to the US. Greatest threat to the US? Am I reading this correctly? Because strong US-Israeli bilateral relations hinders the US from having normal relations with Arab and Muslim countries, as well as increasingly the greater international community. So what they're saying is, well, let's get rid of Israel and we'll go back to normal relations with all the other nations in the Middle East. That is the policy under Obama. And of course, the Obama deal, this article, which appeared in the Jewish press again in July 2015, makes it very clear why Israel is very concerned. The US really implied that they would protect Iran and their nuclear sites from an attack by Israel. That's the headline. And the article read like this. The Obama deal explicitly states that the US and the other P5 plus one powers can help Iran deflect and even respond to sabotage and nuclear threats to its nuclear sites. It allows Western powers to help Iran to protect its nuclear sites and possibly even to stage a counterattack on the source of the threat. It's actually back, it's cool, what basically is, it's hidden back in the appendix. And of course this was debated in the campaign and they poo-pooed it and said, oh no, that's not right. But when John Kerry was asked, what does it really say, he couldn't answer. Didn't have an answer. Israel believes that that's the case. No question about what they think, that America would have to come in on the side of Iran against any Israeli attack. You know, ladies and gentlemen, if you read the Bible carefully, there is one inescapable conclusion, and it is this. But the destiny of all people and all nations on earth is intertwined with Israel. Inescapable conclusion. For Israel is the only immortal nation. And there are two declarations in the one book of the Bible, Jeremiah. Jeremiah 30 verse 11 and 46 verse 28 both make this statement. That though, and this is God speaking to his own people Israel through the prophet Jeremiah, though I make a full end of all nations, which is telling you that they're all going to disappear one day, whether I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee. He's talking to Israel. Israel as a nation will never be destroyed. That's the one thing that at least the Bible agrees with on Donald Trump, with Donald Trump, who said in the campaign that Israel will be there forever. And he's quite right on that point. He doesn't know why. All other nations on earth are destined to disappear during the millennial age of a 1,000-year reign of Christ. The purpose of the millennium is to integrate all nations into Israel and to fulfill God's promise to Abraham that he would make of him a great nation. I'm not talking about Israel in the past. He's talking about Israel in the future and especially beyond the 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. So we ask the question, given that fact, given what we've seen, given the fact that the nations of the world are sorely troubled by the election of this man, can Donald Trump make America great again? Well, we know politics has a very long history of broken promises. There's a few of those in this country. And policies of self-interest. When you come into power, it's a golden opportunity, isn't it, to pursue things that are of self-interest. And there are two biblical declarations that will impact the outcome of Donald Trump's intentions. Jeremiah chapter 10 and verse 23 says, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his steps. Those who have had some experience of life know that that's true. It is not in man to direct his steps. So on that basis alone, he's sure to make a mess of it, as most or all others do. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 33 makes this statement. The lot, and a lot of course here, a bit like an election, isn't it? Right? Let's just put it in the context of an election. The lot is cast into the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of the Lord. In other words, it doesn't matter what Donald Trump's intentions might be, he will end up fulfilling God's purpose and God's will So all of these declarations of support for Israel have to be met by one passage of scripture that he's going to have a problem with. And it's this one. Jeremiah chapter 30, verses 12 to 14 is very clear about events just prior to what the Bible calls Armageddon, the great battle in the land of Israel involving all nations. We'll talk a bit more about that in a moment. It's very clear about what has to happen in relation to Israel before then. And it says this, "For thus saith the Lord," he's talking to Israel, "thy bruise is incurable, and thy wound is grievous. There is none to plead thy cause, that thou mayest be bound up. There is no healing medicines. All thy lovers have forgotten thee. They seek thee not. For I have wounded thee," he says, "with the wound of an enemy." And so it goes on. Clearly telling us, ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't matter what Trump's intentions are in relation to Israel, that prophecy will come to pass. And Trump, of course, says he wants to make a friend of Vladimir Putin, doesn't he? Well, Vladimir Putin's got some very clear intentions in the Middle East that are not going to accord with those that belong to Donald Trump. So what about Russia and Israel today? Of the 8.18 million people in the land called Israel, 1.6 million are Russian Jews. You know, Vladimir Putin recently made the statement that half of the Jewish population speak the Russian language, and that the Jewish people really owe their cultural existence to Russian influence. Yeah, so he's making progress. Real progress. But 1.6 million Russian Jews, most of whom came in the last 30 years or 25 years since the collapse of the USSR, and 1.7 million are Arabs. In May 2013, there were 10,000 Red Army, that is Red Army Russian veterans, who fought against Hitler in World War II. So good for the calculation. The Second World War ended in 1945. How old are these guys? Well, they're pretty old. They're up in the late 80s. Into the mid-90s, aren't they? But there were 10,000 of them living in Israel. And many of them, of course, were invited aboard a ship, that you'll see in a minute. So the family links and the visits between Moscow and Tel Aviv are much stronger than they are between Tel Aviv and New York. There's a lot more traffic, a lot more family involvement between Russia and Israel. And of course, you can go there to the land today and you can see sites like this. On the back of this rather dirty car, standing outside the wall of Jerusalem, there is the words, "I love Putin." That's a common sentiment in Israel today. He visited there in June 2012. He said his talks with Netanyahu had been detailed and very useful. Shimon Peres, who recently died, of course, who was the president of Israel at the time, he went to Moscow in November 2012 for the inauguration of the Jewish Museum and Tolerance Center in Moscow. The Russian warship we spoke about docked at Haifa Harbor on the 13th of May 2013, and many of those veterans were taken aboard that ship. And there was quite a long article about this, actually. But this is what the Russians said about that. See there in the green on the screen? They said, "There is something to be understood from this for the contemporary Middle East. Where we decided to anchor is a clear statement, both to the Israelis and the entire region. There is a growing cooperation between Israel and Russia, and the Bible says it has to happen." The little quote at the bottom of that screen, Hosea 12 verse 1, it's one of many in the prophetic scriptures that tell us that there has to come an agreement or a covenant of some kind between the latter-day Assyrian, which we can demonstrate very easily, is Russia, and Israel. So that little quotation ends, "And they do make a covenant with the Assyrians, and Israel is already doing it." It's going to become much stronger. Netanyahu has formed a strong friendship with Vladimir Putin, who is now seen by many in this world as the saviour of Christian values. Yeah. As the saviour of Christians from the oppression by Muslims. He's seen as the champion of Western society. Ridiculous, isn't it? A man's a thug. And he has a history that would make your hair curl if you had any. But you see, God is using him too. Netanyahu disagreed with the Six Nations who lifted sanctions on Iran and responded by improving his relationship and Israel's relationship with Russia, particularly in regard to Syria. So Debka, a reliable information source, reported on the 10th of June 2016 that Russian President Vladimir Putin and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu decided at their June the 7th meeting in Moscow to deepen the military ties between the Russian and Israeli armed forces. They said this historic decision spells the end of the IDF's unique relationship with the US. What Debka did not mention was the fact that Israel already had a military agreement with Russia. They had one dating back to the 6th of September 2010. All they were doing was renewing it. So there is deep ties being built up between Russia and Israel. And the Bible says it was going to happen. It was all typified in the days of Ahaz, the king of Judah, who when he was offered a sign by God, he rejected it. He had no faith like the nation of Israel today. He rejected God's help. And he went to the Assyrians and made a covenant with them. It's all going to happen again, because the events that occurred in the days of his son Hezekiah, when the Assyrians came down, are used in the word of God over and over and over again as a type of what's going to happen in the latter days. So it has to happen. And the Russian leader tried to convince Netanyahu in all of these talks by saying that the presence of the Russian Navy in the port, two ports in fact, the ports that Russian money built in Syria. He says that the presence of Russian ships there, if you let us guard your gas fields and your oil fields, etc., you let us do that, then no Arab or Muslim military force, such as those of Iran, Syria and Hezbollah, would attack you. That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Yeah, and you can see where that's headed. So what would a covenant between Russia and Israel achieve? Well, Russian control of Syria removes the last enemy among the nations surrounding Israel. Russian domination of Iran would end the nuclear threat to Israel. Any agreement would include Russian approval for Israel to eliminate the Iranian-backed Hezbollah in southern Lebanon, who are a real problem to them. And Israel, we know from the Bible, will annex the West Bank, that is ancient Samaria, in fulfillment of Ezekiel 38 and verse 8. Another word about that in a minute. That would be supported by Russia. And the Gaza Strip would become the homeland of the Palestinians. If there is to be a Palestinian state, that is where it will be. Now, Ezekiel 38 verse 8 is very clear. It requires that the West Bank, so-called, is to be part of Israel proper when Gog, that power that we'll talk about in a moment, will come into the land of Israel. Because in that West Bank, 90% of what's called biblically the mountains of Israel. Gog is to come against the mountains of Israel. 90% of them are in the West Bank. And so when Netanyahu was elected a couple of years ago, he said, he made it very clear, Israel will annex the West Bank. And in due course, they will. And they'll get support from one of their partners. That partner, we believe, will be Russia. So things are happening apace. But the agreement between Israel and Russia is going to come undone. And Russia knows a little bit about this from their own history. Those of you who know a little bit of history about pre-World War II era will know this, that Hitler made an agreement with the dictator of Russia, Joseph Stalin, that they would leave each other alone. He had no intentions of leaving Russia alone. And so what they did on the 23rd of August 1939 was that Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union signed what they called the Nazi-Soviet Non-Aggression Pact, agreeing that the two countries would not attack each other. Within 18 months, on the 22nd of June 1941, the pact was broken when Nazi Germany attacked the Soviet Union. And of course we know that Stalin utterly relied upon that guarantee, that covenant that had been made. He was so stunned. He was not seen in public for 2 weeks. He was always speaking on the radio. There was no television in those days. He was always on the radio. He was not heard from for 2 weeks. Well, he had a few problems. He was so confident that that agreement would hold, he'd shot his best generals, who he saw as competition to his rule. And the army was in a mess. They couldn't defend themselves for some good 3 or 4 weeks before they got their act together. Too late by then. German forces were almost up to Moscow. It's going to happen to Israel. The Russians know a bit about that kind of thing, the treachery that they experienced at the hands of Hitler. They learned from that. And the Bible says in Ezekiel 38, verse 10, that at the same time shall things come into thy mind. And we're going to find out who this power is in a second. Because we're talking here about Ezekiel chapter 38, one of the most important chapters of the Bible in relation to things that we're witnessing right now. And Brother Ham's translation agrees with that of the Amplified Bible. It reads this way, "Son of man, set thy face against Gog of the land of Magog," so he has a special land. "The Prince of Rosh," so he's a powerful individual, "Prince of Rosh, Meshech and Tubal, and prophesy concerning him." So who is the Rosh involved here? Well, Jesenius, the celebrated lexicographer, says this. When he's commenting on Ezekiel 38 verses 2 and 3 in reference to this name, Rosh, he says it's a proper name of a northern nation mentioned with Tubal and Meshech, undoubtedly the Russians. Can't argue with that, because history demonstrates that it's the case. Mentioned by Byzantine writers under the name Rus. And he says that they dwelt near the river Ra, or Volga. So where's the river Volga? Well, here's a map of Europe. And you can see that blue line there running into the Caspian Sea is the river Volga. That's where the Rus, the Rus, the Russians, first established their kingdom. Way back in the 900 ADs. And their first capital was Kiev. You see, when you look at what historians say was the land of Magog, it just happens to include the country called Ukraine, which is why Putin wants it. Because this man Gog, and Gog means a ruler, a dictator, is of the land of Magog. He's going to get the heartland of the Russian kingdom, the Russian Empire, back again. That's why he's doing what he's doing to the Ukraine. Gog, as a title, is referred to in Unger's Bible Dictionary. And he says this, Ezekiel 38 and 39, which deal with Gog the prince and Magog his land, describe the actual invasion of Palestine, as was then called, now called Israel, by a great northern confederacy, ostensibly headed up by Russia. In that, he's quite correct. The scene depicts a gigantic outburst of anti-Semitism and a colossal attempt to overrun Palestine and annihilate the Jew. Gog means, in the Hebrew language, a roof, or the one at the top, a dominating power, a dictator. I think there is a dictator in Russia right now, isn't there? I think his name's called Vladimir Putin. Whether he's the one that leads them into the Middle East, or there be another, we don't know. What we do know is that he's got the system in place. And the time is drawing near when all nations, as Ezekiel 38 and Daniel 11 and other chapters of Joel 3, describe Zechariah 14, they all describe this massive invasion of the land of Israel by this northern confederacy. And they're opposed, of course, by Britain and those powers that are in harmony with Britain. And it's all because they're coming to the battle called Armageddon. That's when things are going to change, dramatically change in our world. So where have Christadelphians stood on these matters in the past? What's been the Christadelphian attitude towards America in Bible prophecy? Well, I want to show you. I want to go right back to when Christadelphians adopted that name in the middle of the 19th century, in the time of the American Civil War, 1863-64. Our community adopted the name Christadelphians, Brethren of Christ. What's our attitude? What was our attitude to America? Well, John Thomas, one of the early Christadelphians, wrote quite extensively about America. He was asked a question on the 20th of January, 1860. The query was, in the revolutions of the world, what part has America to perform? He answered that with a 4-page article in the Herald of the Kingdom and Age to Come in 1860. This is the very first paragraph, the opening paragraph. Under the heading, The Destiny of the United States, he says, By America in the inquiry, we presume, is meant the United States. In reply, we remark that this confederacy is not represented by any prophetic symbols, nor are there any verbal predictions concerning it, after the manner of those concerning Babylon, Persia, Macedonia, Rome, the Ten Kingdoms, Russia, and so forth. In other words, what he's saying is that the Bible is silent about America's involvement in the events of Armageddon. No mention at all. And he's quite right. He followed that up when he wrote a book called Eureka, which is an exposition of the book of Revelation, some years later. And he wrote this about America. Seeing then that the deity swept into the abyss the whole human family except Noah and his house for this crime, why should not the American world be punished, being guilty of the same iniquity? There is every reason to conclude that judgment will fall upon it with great severity. Its idolatry of self is God-defiant, and it needs to be taught that there is one almightier than the dollar and stronger than the human will. And he adds this: there is no symbolical revelation of events to be developed upon the American arena. There are, however, general declarations which show what must of necessity be developed in the course of the rainbowed angels, and it's a reference to Christ and his saints coming to bring judgment upon the nations. The rainbowed angels' mission upon this continent from one end of it to the other. Thus the principle is oracular, that all nations shall come and worship before the all-powerful Yahweh Elohim, one of the titles of our God, and that they will learn righteousness. Christadelphian teaching from that day was that there's nothing about America in the latter days in the Bible. And events are proving that to be the case, because things are going to happen. And Donald Trump may well be the catalyst for those things to happen. Now, we all know the slogan of his campaign was, "I'm going to make America great again." Well, a cartoonist preparing a cartoon for an article in the Time magazine in June this year put on America Donald Trump's cap the logo, "Make America 1968 again." Now, what's important about that, do you think? Well, the article said this: no less a symbol of that awful 1968 political season than Lyndon Johnson used to favour the biblical quote, "Come, let us reason together." Johnson himself failed in the end, and so did the entire country in that bleeding year. And it was a year of blood. Generations ago, we paid a steep price for our rage back then, and if we're not careful, we'll pay it again. It's a reference to that critical year in human history, modern human history, 1968. I'm not sure whether you're familiar with just how important that year was. Historians know how important it was. Time magazine, on the 20th anniversary, 1988, issued that Time magazine that you can see there on the screen. The BBC had a three-part series on 1968 in 2008, a radio series. The Time magazine, again, had a Time magazine on the 40th anniversary of 1968. The world knows how critical it was. So is this important to Bible students? It's very important to Bible students, and I want to show you why. This is why we read from Luke chapter 21 and the words of our Lord Jesus Christ to his disciples here this afternoon. And we began to read from Luke 21 verse 24. "And they," that is the Jewish people that Christ is talking about, "shall fall by the edge of the sword," history shows it's true, "as you led away captive into all nations," that happened, "and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles." They say that there has been 1,100 armies that have trodden Jerusalem down in its history. That could be the case. "So Jerusalem will be trodden down of the Gentiles until," there's going to be a termination, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And we believe that Jerusalem has had its last complete treading down. And Zechariah 14 and verses 2 and 3 are clear about that. It's had its last complete treading down. It will never be taken completely from Jewish control again until Christ is in the earth. So this day, this event, the Six-Day War of June 1967, is like a milestone stuck in history. Now it's important because you see the next year was 1968. So what's the next verse in Luke chapter 21? Well, it's verse 25. And it says this, "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring." So what are these signs in the sun, moon and stars? We had a lot of people a week or so ago out there looking at the big moon. Is it that kind of sign? No. Christ is using symbolic language. All through the Bible, we have symbolic language. The sun, because it rules the day, represents governments that rule the nations. The moon, that derives its light from the sun, is speaking of state religions, state-sponsored religions. And of course, nobody would argue about stars, would they? The world is full of stars, film stars, sports stars. We use that language every day of the week. We have no problem with that at all. So here he's talking about powers. And 1968 saw the beginning of that, and the world knows it happened, but they don't know why. Christ is telling us why. Because we know what happened. This word perplexity here, upon the earth, amongst ordinary people, they've got perplexity. What's that word mean? In the Greek of the New Testament, it means at a loss for a way to proceed, without resources. You've got no way forward. What are we going to do? This is why Donald Trump was elected, because they couldn't see any way forward with a repetition of the Obama regime in Hillary Clinton. That's why he's elected. Not because he's a moral man, not because they like him, but because they want someone to do something. And at least he promised them. Time will tell. So the powers of heaven, the next verse, verse 26 says, "And men's hearts failing them for fear, and were looking after those things that are coming on the earth." For the powers of heaven, what are they? Governments, religious organizations, peoples, powers of heaven shall be shaken, and they are being shaken. And the sea, we know, is a symbol in the Word of God in many places, four nations. So here you've got the sea and the waves roaring. Let's have a look and see what the Time magazine said back in 1988 on the 20th anniversary of 1968. Amazing article. Now I'm quite sure that the writer of this article was not referring to Luke chapter 21. But you'd think he was. Under headings like this, like a knife blade, the years severed the past from the future. The spasms of unrest seemed almost psychologically coordinated, as if a mysterious common impulse had swept through the nervous system of a global generation. 1968 had the vibrations of earthquake about it. America shuddered. History cracked open. The year was pivotal and messy. It produced vivid theatre. It reverberates still in the American mind. 1968 was tragedy and horrific entertainment. Deaths of heroes, uprisings, suppressions. The end of dreams, blood in the streets of Chicago and Paris and Saigon, and at Christmas time, almost ludicrously, man floating around the moon. That was 1968. And they went on like this. After 20 years, the apocalyptic events of 1968 are still reverberating. Apocalyptic? That's a biblical word. Under the heading, "An End of Heroes," they said, "The year had many legacies, but the assassinations were among the most important and were the hardest to bear. They altered history and broke something essential in the national morale. They broke hope." Tom Hayden was the leader of the anti-Vietnam War movement of those times. And this is what he said. "The best leaders of our time were dead," Hayden says now. "They have been murdered. That is the heart of the tragedy. By 1968, I knew I was part of an apocalypse, which is different from the early idealism. Look what he ended with. You feel you are carried by events that are out of your control. That's exactly what the word perplexity means. Our Lord Jesus Christ was telling us that this was going to happen, ladies and gentlemen. And that is a long time ago. And we know from what's happening that we're very close to the events that he next talks about. 1968, with the assassinations of Martin Luther and Robert Kennedy and others, and all the trouble that went through the world. Paris looked like that. You wouldn't want to go to Paris then, would you? Modern civilization had never seen anything like this. Yeah, because Christ said it was going to happen. The terminal event of 1967, the incredible victory of Israel, with God's help, that was the milestone, and from that was to flow all of these events. And it was all because God had placed in the earth once again the nation of Israel. And so Christ goes on to speak of it. He says, and he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees. When they now shoot forth, ye see and know of your own selves that summer, which by the way is a time of harvest, and Armageddon just happens to mean a heap of sheaves in a valley for judgment, a time of harvest. You know that summer is nigh at hand. So who's this fig tree? Well, of course, the fig tree in the Word of God is a symbol for the nation of Israel. But what about all the trees? Well, trees are used symbolically in the Bible for nations. In Ezekiel 31, trees are referred to and used as symbols for many nations. So when Israel became a nation in 1948, there were 57 nations in the United Nations. There are now 192. That's quite an increase, isn't it? Behold the fig tree, Israel, but not just Israel, and all the trees. Look at them popping up everywhere. Yeah, we know we're in that time. So what's going to happen next? So likewise ye, he says in verse 31, when ye see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. So we're in this time. We're in this period of time. Israel becoming a nation state in 1948. The mad period of nuclear armament. Mad. Mutual assured destruction. We saw the 1967 war, the milestone year. We saw 1968, the era of perplexity unfolding. We saw many things, didn't we? 73, 74, the fuel crisis because of the war of the Middle East. 87, the collapse of the stock market. 91, another recession. And, of course, the Gulf War. 2001, the bringing down of the Twin Towers in New York. Shaped. The world knows how it's shaped the world we live in today. And, of course, we've got all sorts of things going on. And the global financial crisis of 2008, which guaranteed the big one that's coming soon. And many know that that's the case. In this article from October 2016, under the heading, The Crash of 2016, Wall Street Gets Ready, we read this. In the more than 6 years since the 2008 Wall Street crash, nothing has been done to rein in the abuses of the parasites in pinstripes that were its cause. Another crash is inevitable. Now this writer says, my guess is it will come in late 2016 when the banksters, these are the men in pinstripes, have selected the candidate for president that will be as dependable an ally as the incumbent, namely Obama. He or she will replace, as they did in 2008, to ensure maximum political protection. Well, it didn't happen for them, did it? Clinton didn't get in. And now they're very worried. You know why they're worried? Because Trump says, I'm going to start spending money to rebuild the infrastructure of America. You start spending money, inflation goes up. You know what has to happen then? Interest rates have to go up. There's zero in the US at the moment. And Janet Yellen, the head of Treasury, has been saying she's going to raise them. She's been holding off and holding off. Well, Trump is going to ensure that they go up. Guess what brought about the 1930 depression? the raising of interest rates by the Federal Treasury in the United States of America. So Trump could well be the catalyst. Could come sooner, he says. Unscripted, just like I've said. Set off perhaps by a bad debt in the almost 300 trillion derivatives casino. But whenever it comes, what happens next? Another panic on Wall Street? The banksters desperate to call in their bets and not to be the one left standing when the music stops? Forced into bankruptcy? Yeah, it's coming. And Christ said it was going to come. In Luke chapter 17, he said it was going to come. Now you can read that section of scripture for yourself, but I'll tell you what's in it. Check me out. As it was in the days of Noah and the days of Lot, so shall it be in the days of the day of the coming of the Son of Man. That's what he says. So what were they doing? Eating and drinking? Marrying and being given in marriage? Buying and selling? Building and planting? You can only do those things with money in your pockets. So what happened in the days of Noah? General prosperity. And then God said, right, time's come. He locks Noah and his family away in the ark, and within a week, all their prosperity was underwater. So what happened in the days of Lot? Great prosperity on the plain of Sodom and Gomorrah. He sends his angels and he plucks his servants out of that city, and they couldn't even get down their latte in the local cafe, because by 9 a.m. they were blown to smithereens and all their prosperity came to an end. It's going to happen again. All right, and the servants of God will be whipped away to a place of judgment here on earth, into the company of Jesus Christ. And this world is going to go down the gurgler, big time. All their prosperity collapsed in a day when the saints were taken away. And it happens like this. We've got history to go on. 1929, stock market crash. By 1930, worldwide depression. It took them 10 years. No prosperity. 10 years. And then only by a war to get out of it. It's going to happen again. But this time, it's going to be the biblical Daniel 12 verses 1 and 2. The time of trouble such as never was. And here could be one of the reasons why a man called Donald Trump is president-elect of the United States of America. God used Bush and Obama to bankrupt America. He may well use Donald Trump to push it over the precipice. We'll have to wait and see. But what we can be sure of is that these are signs of the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ to the earth. He said in the following verses of Luke 21, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Again, symbolic language. Power and great glory is a reference to the fact he has with him his glorified saints. He's sharing this with them. So they've got to be taken before him. When these things begin to come to pass, and nobody can argue with that, then look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. And the outcome will be this. America is going to be smashed. It will be the country, along with China, that will experience the greatest catastrophe in their history. Just like happened in the 1930s. You know what happened in the 1930s? America was so internalized, so desperate to get out of the problems that they were in, they couldn't care less about the rest of the world. So while Hitler is destroying Jews, America just stood and said, not our problem. When Hitler attacks Poland, not our problem. Britain and other countries, including Australia, go to war, but not America. And care less about the rest of the world. Until God says, right. And the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor on the 7th of December 1941. That'll bring you in. And it's going to happen all over again. Which is why John Thomas was quite right when he said, there are no revelations about America in the latter days. The Bible's silent about them. Because history will be repeated. As it very often is. So what are we going to do about that? Just let these things float by? Oh yeah, extraordinary year. We're going to do something about it. and be ready for that day. What we're doing here this afternoon is trying to obey what our Lord Jesus Christ said we should do. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. He didn't mean the silly stuff you hear from pulpits, right? He meant the gospel of the Bible, which is Acts 8 verse 12, which says that the gospel is the kingdom of God on earth. And how you get into it? Through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not exposes himself to condemnation. There are steps that we can take. We need to understand what the Word of God says about our time and about our future and how we can be involved in it. And the day will come. As certain as the sun will rise tomorrow, the day will come when our Lord Jesus Christ will be here to give rewards to those who serve their God in truth and in faithfulness. But you know, and I know, from what we're seeing, the time is running out. Let us each ask ourselves this question: am I going to be ready for that day?